From American Public Media.
There is no sweeter sound than the voice of Julie Fowlis in Carnegie Ever-Loving Hall. Welcome to a special edition of Live From Here, opening night of Carnegie Hall's Migrations, the Making of America Festival. Over the two next months in events across New York City, these performances will explore how migrations have built American art and culture. Tonight explores the crossings from Ireland and Scotland. Now? Director, the secret wizard himself, Mike Elizondo. Our house band tonight includes Sean Martin on keys, Brittany Haas on fiddle, Chris Eldridge on guitar, and Ted Poor on the drums. Oh, what a show, what a show we have for you. Our guests are Tony DeMarco, James Keen, Alice Bretta, Ryan, Paul Modoon, Aoife O'Donovan, Maeve Higgins, Julie Fowlis, Edgar Meyer, and Béla Fleck. Live From Here is supported by Sierra Nevada Brewing Company, standing up for independent voices and beer since 1980, and by Noom, offering a personalized weight loss program that uses psychology and small goals to help lose weight and keep it off for good. Learn more at Noom, N-O-O-M.com. And by Babbel, a European-made language learning program. Babbel teaches practical conversation in Spanish, French, German, and other languages, available in the App Store or online at B-A-B-B-E-L.com. Live From Here is produced by American Public Media. Welcome to the stage, the Pulitzer Prize-winning poet, Paul Muldoon.
I started out in South Belfast by the Lagan's sweet stream, yet I could taste the bitterness of a corrupt regime. It drifted from the river past silos stacked with grain, tobacco smoke all over, Gallagher's blues and greens. The local toffs, decked out in green and orange. It seemed that through our long standoffs, we stayed just out of range. Down on York Street, the smell of hops was heavy on the wind. We never once would give up hope, though hope seemed at an end. For years, coal dust would cast a pall over the great white linen hall. Our huge regard for little sects had us see all in retrospect. And I could hear a screeching sound from the shipyards and mills as I strolled by the famine mound, some knew as Plaguey Hill. The screeching of a bird of death rose above
my
drums.
My father taking his last breath would push me into life. My ears as a producer, TV and radio. All those trailers and teasers, the white hot prairie shows. I'd seen so much go up in flames, kneecappings and car bombs. As much as I loved making films, I wasn't writing poems. Though I was really at a loss, and Dobbins are made of ants. Just then I'd met a New York glass, for whom alas I'd fall. I knew not where our road would end, only that it must first wend along the Wensum and the Cam like an electrocardiogram. I knew not if the road would lead to fortune, good or ill, but I would leave my seat and breed back there on Plaguey Hill.
And though we prize heredity and so much that's on fire, we also prize the unforeseen, what comes out of the blue, as when Lord Dionysus takes on Lord Apollo. My son and daughter may be chips off on a stumbling block, yet from the start they took the shapes of shapeshifters who plucked at my heartstrings as a harp, while I myself walked a tightrope between the North Tower and the South, and sang a song to stop my mouth. The gap I tried to close with work is one I never filled. And all those years spent in New York, I sighed for Plaguey Hill.
Retirement, I sometimes take a jaunt back through Belfast's new neighborhoods to visit my old haunts. The men who gave no quarter when it came to queens and popes now make very short order of gaslit gastropubs. in former times, both toughs could stage a shouting match.
Now the local executive executes nothing much. It seems Titanic has been raised from her watery grave. Yet much we thought was laid to rest was rested half alive. For when Goliath takes the field, we know Rob Powers what he'll wield. We know two Davids in the wings, he fits the stone into his sling. The bird of death rolls up the sleeve on which it's wiped its bill, and casts about for some reprieve from life on Plaguey Hill.
And cast about for some reprieve from a life on Plaguey Hill.
That's the world premiere of a brand new Paul Muldoon poem called Plaguey Hill. And it's also our song of the week. Well, since we are here at Carnegie Hall celebrating musical migration, we're excited to launch a brand new segment for classical music lovers. Dead Hungarian composer Béla Bartók sits down for drinks and a chat with some of history's great composers in Bartók with Bartók. The stories may seem crazy, but we promise they're 100% true for reals. Please make welcome dead Hungarian composer Béla Bartók.
Hello, guys. Hello, buddies. And welcome back to another episode of Bartók with Bartók. I'm your host, dead Hungarian composer Béla Bartók. And yes, this is a Hungarian accent. Don't worry about it. Let's talk to our first guest. Okay, guys, okay, buddies. You know and you love this first guy. He's German. He wrote some real bangers like Toccata NC and Carnival. And he's drinking a Hefeweizen. Welcome, Robert Schumann.
Danke, danke. Jawohl.
Okay, wow. So nice to see you, Schumann. Tell us, what is something that we should know about you?
Well, Bartók, lots of people know me for being one of the great romantic composers. And also that Brahms was one of my protégés.
Okay, wow, that is very cool.
But what you all might not know is that at the age of 22, I destroyed my ability to play the piano when a quack doctor put my hand in a finger-stretching machine.
Ouch.
Yes, I couldn't so much as pick my nose. So this is why I ended up focusing on composing.
Wow, that is fascinating.
I also had syphilis.
Ooh, very cool. Okay, guys. Okay, buddies. Please welcome my next guest. He wrote The Damnation of Faust. He's drinking a nice Bordeaux. Welcome, Hector Berlioz.
Oui, oui, oui. Bonsoir, bonsoir. Comment allez-vous?
Oh, wow, Berlioz. Welcome to Bartók with Bartók. I heard you had a very funny story for us.
Mais oui, I have a hilarious story that makes me crack up every time.
Wow, we are waiting with bait on our breath.
I discovered my fiancé's mother had promised my beloved to someone else. I decided to buy a disguise and kill them both, and then myself.
Okay, not a very funny story.
Don't worry, I did not do it. The funny part is, when I got to her house, I realized I left the disguise at home. Instead of murder, suiciding everybody, I just went and slept with as many women as I could to get back at her.
Oh, wow, that's the most French thing I've ever heard.
I also had syphilis.
Oh, okay. Okay, guys. Okay, buddies. My final guest needs no introduction. He's composed many of the great operas and concertos. He's from Salzburg, and he's lapping up a bowl of cream. It's Mozart.
Hello, yeah. Thank you so much for having me.
Okay, Mozart, please tell us something interesting about yourself and please don't say syphilis.
Yeah, I like to pretend that I was a little kitty cat.
Oh, okay. Now that is very interesting.
I also had the syphilis.
Oh, well, that's all the time we have for. Thank you for listening to Bird Talk with Bird Talk. Join us next week when we chat with Johann Sebastian Bach, who had 20 children with his second cousin.
Meow.
So long, guys, and bye-bye, buddies.
The Live From Here radio players, and it gives me so much pleasure to introduce you to one of my favorite vocalists in the world, Julie Fowlis.
Pa Felicia, that was a couple of traditional Gaelic myth music songs, known in Gaelic as Pusht a Béal, or literally translated tunes from the mouth. These are songs for dancing to. So it's such an honour to be here in Carnegie Hall. I have played Carnegie Hall before, but the small one in Dunfermline in Scotland. So it's it's very nice to be here.
So it's kind of a soft debut for you here, really. Yeah.
Now, the songs of the supernatural have always fascinated me. I'm originally from the Outer Hebrides of Scotland, and the next song is about the seal people. It was often said that the seals on the west side of the island of North Uist were actually the children of Scandinavian royalty, and who were cursed by an evil foster mother and banished to the sea to live out their lives as creatures of the ocean. And on certain feast days in the dead of night, they are said to return to the shore to shed their skin and dance upon the sand before returning to the sea once more at the break of day. And the chorus of this next song is supposed to be the cry of the seal woman herself.
Oi, oi, oi. Oi, oi, oi. Oi, oi, oi. Haram mi man adarai. Smedek sin jith sha, smedek sin jith. Gichegen in Rilkevi Nach Eichschiff Kermarsch und Plui Galit Chenet und Krui Krein Oi, oi, oi Oi, oi, oi Oi, 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 oi. Haram mi man adarai Smishan yen evich gewin Gumbiawach mi munis gedam Gad medik yen agma vuawach Ben uasal mi ohi dila Oi, oi, oi Oi, 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 haram mi man adarai. Hikken smiara, hikken drud, hik gachiani usinit, hikken bratan harhuan. Glawn haglwysr mish Oi, oi, oi Oi, oi, oi Oi, oi, oi Haram mi ma
That is Julie Fowlis from the Highlands in Scotland, all the way here in New York City. This instrumental break is supported by Sierra Nevada Brewing Company, crafted to be instrumental to your weekend.
Now that's what I call copy.
For this break, we have some special guests. You may have heard me talk about the 11th Street Bar before on our show. Beautiful sort of expat bar down there on 11th Street between A and B. I started going to an Irish music session there on Sunday nights, right when I moved to town about, oh my God, 10, 11 years ago. And met this fellow over here who presides over that session. who I've also talked about on the radio show a lot, figured the only way we could one up those segments by having the actual man here. We have brought the 11th Street Bar session to Carnegie Hall. This is Tony DeMarco. Tony! Now, forgive me, Tony. DeMarco, it just wasn't the last name I was expecting from the fellow who would run the Irish session at 11th Street Bar.
Well, my mom is half Irish, Patricia Dempsey.
Close enough.
So I think I'm qualified. But the other three quarters is Italian. But we grew up in East Flatbush in Brooklyn. And
where are Brooklynites at?
Okay. Very, very parochial neighborhood with the Catholics and the church. And a lot of the Italians and Irish were predominant in that neighborhood. And they all intermarried. I'm three generations of Italian and Irish marriages.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
And so did you pick up Irish music then from your mom, or was it some other?
Started with Appalachian music and some bluegrass, and then found out like the tons of Irish music in Brooklyn and the Bronx and Manhattan and the sessions and stuff, and started doing that, and met Patty Reynolds in Brooklyn, a great Longford fiddle player, and then I just kind of fell into it, and they liked the fact that I could play, you know, bluegrass and country music as well as the Irish stuff, so I got a lot of gigs with the Irish bands.
Can you, before we actually show people how it sounds at 11th Street Bar on a Sunday night, can you confirm a story that I heard about you, that you went back to Ireland and you had like really long hair? Is this possible?
Yes.
And you sound like you, and you go and maybe order a pint and there's a session going, you break out a fiddle and people are just like, what's about to happen with this New York dude? Is this true?
Yeah, pretty much. Me and my guitar player, Cesar Pacifici, were in a pub up in South Sligo in Gertrude. And one of the guys came in for his midday pint and saw us in the back playing and said, he ran over to P.J. Hernan's house and said, "Geez, P.J., you got to get down to the pub. There's two Red Indians playing Irish music in the pub." So that's how I got the CD on the Smithsonian. It's called the Sligo Indians.
Oh my goodness! Okay, so you've brought some 11th Street veterans with you.
Yes, I got the great James Keane here from Dublin, and very very happy to have him here with us. And he's been a staple in the New York scene for many years, and we played a lot together over the years. And Brittany's going to join us, and also Alice Breeder Ryan's going to get up and do a little couple of Shawno steps for you.
All right. So, by all means, go down, check the 11th Street Bar out, but we'll try and bring it to you tonight. Thank you. welcome back to Live From Here. Mr. Tony DeMarco and his merry band of 11th Street Barers. Oh, my kid in that candy store yet again. And also because Aoife O'Donovan is here.
Hello.
This song has a connection to our theme.
It does, it does. My father is from Ireland, from County Cork. And I grew up spending all my summers there. And this song was sort of written just as sort of a tribute to the beautiful coastline of West Cork and also to my late grandfather. It's called In the Magic Hour. In the magic hour when the moon is low and the sky's the kind of blue that you're thinking of, but you don't know. The toothless donkey runs around and all the fair children, they run around and all the other children, they make no sound.
Thank you.
Aoife O'Donovan with In the Magic Hour. We're so pleased to have this next guest returning to the show. She's a comedian, a contributing writer to the New York Times, I've heard of it, and author of Maeve in America, Maeve in America. Reading from that now, please welcome Maeve Higgins.
Thank you, Chris. In January 2014, a girl from Cove in Ireland, formerly known as Queenstown, journeyed across the Atlantic and skipped rosy-cheeked off an airplane at JFK Airport. That was me, and I had too much blush on. In January of 1892, a girl from Queenstown, now known as Cove, skipped rosy-cheeked off a boat at Ellis Island to start her new life. That was Annie Moore. She was flushed at the fuss being made of her by the officials on the island. You see, Annie Moore was the first immigrant through the new processing center that opened its doors on January 1st of that year. Now, maybe her rosy cheeks were caused by the icy wind whipping through the harbor, or maybe she just lit up with anticipation of seeing her parents for the first time in many years, and maybe the relief of no longer being her two little brothers' sole guardian as she had been on their voyage and back home in Ireland. I really have no idea why she was blushing. I grew up knowing all about the people that left my hometown, but really nothing about what happened next. Cove is an island in the mouth of Cork Harbour. It's the departure point for more than 2 million Irish people between 1845 and 1945. Cove was the last place Titanic stopped before it. Well, I don't want to ruin the movie. So you see, this whole leaving thing, it's in me. Every immigrant has a story of one life left behind and another one started anew. Annie Moore, the first immigrant through the gates of Ellis Island, she never had any papers. She was an undocumented, unaccompanied minor traveling with her two little brothers, and she sailed right in. In fact, she was welcomed by the US authorities, who gave her a gold coin to commemorate the occasion, and she was reunited with her parents. I'm here on an O-1 visa. I'm officially an alien of extraordinary ability. Thank you. That's my Tinder bio. I think a lot about Annie and about me, and I think about the people who were simply born here, and the people who died trying to get here, and the people who have lived here since childhood but just don't have a path to citizenship. And I'm really blown away by the dumb luck involved in it all. Annie settled just a couple of miles away from Ellis Island on the Lower East Side. She lived with her parents and her brothers, and then she married a clerk in a bakery. They had 11 children, but only 5 of those children made it through to adulthood. Can you even imagine burying your children like that? I definitely can't. I tuck that part away in the, she must have been different from us, with fewer feelings. You know that folder? The delusional one full of current stories from far off places that are just too sad to bear. Annie died when she was 50 years old. I recently went for a wander around Annie's old neighborhood, and I passed St. Mary's, which is the local church founded by Irish immigrants, which was rebuilt after being burned down by anti-Catholic nativists in the 1830s. By the time Annie arrived, the Irish had a surer footing in the city's political and social life. They were clannish and looked out for their own. I've got mixed feelings about this. I'm so glad that they made it, but I'm sorry that they often stood on the backs of other marginalized communities to do so, and I'm sorry that many of us pulled the ladder up after ourselves. A lot has changed since Annie Moore sailed across the Atlantic. The ban on Chinese immigrants, which was in place when she arrived, that was lifted long ago. But Travel Ban 3.0 now blocks immigrants and refugees from 7 other countries. That ban was created and supported by people whose own parents and grandparents walked through that same Ellis Island door, the same one Annie did. Catholic churches are no longer being set alight by nativists. The attackers come now for temples and mosques and synagogues, causing fear and sometimes death to the worshippers inside. I'm afraid we're hearing echoes so loud they've become the sound of today. I don't believe in good or bad immigrants. Annie Moore never made a fortune. She never wrote a book or invented a computer, and why should she?
Why should any immigrant be deemed extraordinary to deserve a place at the table? I think Annie did enough. She was just one woman who lived a short life and a hard life. And Annie, I think, lives on today, not just in her descendants. She lives on in every person arriving from a country shot through with rebellion and hunger, and in every immigrant that gives America her humanity.
Amen, Maeve. Maeve Higgins, she'll be back in the second half. Make welcome Béla, Fleck, and Edgar Meyer. Edgar Meyer song there, Uncommon Ritual, from an album of the same name. Do one of your tunes now, Béla. Fleck on the banjo, Edgar Meyer on the double bass. Song of Béla's there called Big Country. They'll be back in the second half. Now reading from James Joyce's Eveline, please welcome back to the stage our very own Aoife O'Donovan.
She sat at the window watching the evening invade the avenue. Her head was leaned against the window curtains, and in her nostrils was the odor of dusty cretonne. She was tired. Few people passed. The man out of the last house passed on his way home. She heard his footsteps clacking along the concrete pavement and afterwards crunching on the cinder path before the new red houses. One time there used to be a field there in which they used to play every evening with other people's children. Then a man from Belfast bought the field and built houses in it. Not like their little brown houses, but bright brick houses with shining roofs. The children of the avenue used to play together in that field. The Divines, the Waters, the Duns, little Keogh the cripple, she and her brothers and sisters. Ernest, however, never played. He was too grown up. Her father used often to hunt them in out of the field with his blackthorn stick, but usually little Keogh used to keep nix and call out when he saw her father coming. Still, they seemed to have been rather happy then. Her father was not so bad then, and besides, her mother was alive. That was a long time ago. She and her brothers and sisters were all grown up. Her mother was dead. Tizzy Dunn was dead too, and the Waters had gone back to England. Everything changes. Now she was going to go away like the others, to leave her home.
It's a song I wrote with my buddy Sean Watkins about the short story Eveline by James Joyce.
We will be right back after a short intermission. You're listening to Live From Here at Carnegie Hall in New York City.
Live From Here is supported by Progressive Insurance, offering a way to buy home insurance with their Home Quote Explorer tool. Custom quotes and rates are available online. Learn more at progressive.com or 1-800-PROGRESSIVE. Now that's progressive. And by Sierra Nevada Brewing Company, family-owned, operated, and argued over since 1980, reminding you to think for yourself, but drink with others. And by Noom, offering a personalized weight loss program that uses psychology and small goals to change habits to help lose the weight and keep it off for good. Learn more at Noom, N-O-O-M.com. And by Babbel, a European-made language learning program. Babbel teaches practical conversation in Spanish, French, German, and other languages. Available in the App Store or online at B-A-B-B-E-L.com. And by OneDrop, the all-in-one solution for people with diabetes, including home delivery of supplies and gear. Machine learning and personalized coaching offers advice for lower numbers every day. More at getonedrop.com. And by Indiana University, they're leading a comprehensive statewide initiative to reduce, prevent, and treat the national opioid addiction crisis. Naloxone training, law, and policy intervention, and ground-level data collection are only the beginning. Learn more at progress.iu.edu. And by certified financial planner professionals, trained in providing holistic financial planning in the client's best interest. For short and long-term goals, from managing debt to saving for college to retirement, letsmakeaplan.org. Join us next week as John Batiste makes his debut as our guest host. Woo! Live from the Fitzgerald Theater in St. Paul. If you have some free time, go to livefromhere.org, where you can learn more about our upcoming shows in Dallas, New York City, Nashville, and more. You can also see video clips from tonight's show and other recent favorites like Jason Isbell, Death Cab for Cutie, Tank and the Bangas, and Eighth Blackbird. All that and more at livefromhere.org. Live From Here is produced by American Public Media. Some Strathspeys and other miscellaneous fiddle music from Scotland. Welcome back to this special edition of Live From Here at opening night of the Migrations Festival at Carnegie Hall. Now, welcome back to the stage, the Live From Here radio players.
Oh,
Oh, wow, honey, this place is great.
Yeah, this is my favorite Irish bar in New York. Like, I used to come here all the time.
Oh.
Let's get some Guinness.
Oh, there's two seats together, honey. Grab them. Oh, here comes our waitress.
Hi. Y'all right? Bang on. How is it hurting?
Sorry, what?
Welcome to McInerney's. I was airwigging the same as this boy who's looking for the black stuff.
I'm so sorry. I love that, but I can't quite understand what you're saying.
I think she's saying she recognizes me from when I used to come here.
Oh, look who's acting the maggot. I asked if you wanted a Guinness, you cultured also.
Oh, a Guinness. Yeah, round of that, please. Yeah.
Yes, yes, and whiskey chasers.
Savage. Out on the lash, are you?
I think so.
Sucking diesel. I'll get your drinks.
Okay, thank you.
Wow, this place is way more authentic than I remember. I mean, I can barely understand the thing she says.
I know, I was trying to interpret. It's like, gosh, are we in Ireland?
So look, this is like a sing-along place. They like to sing here.
Oh, that's so cute, great.
All right, folks, here's another one. It's called the Odd Triangle. Sing along if you know it. And the Odd Triangle. When jingle, jangle. All along the banks of the Royal Canal.
Oh, that was so fun.
You're right. Got two of the black stuff for you and your whiskey.
Thank you.
She's a devil for a drink.
Oh, I hope that's a good thing.
Kraken. Grand girl, ain't she fond of a pint?
I'm sorry.
It's going to take donkey's years to get this one in tatters and mankies before the place is shammered.
Oh, yes, I will take a menu.
Yeah.
You're a funny one, fair play. She's Delira and Exira. We'll get you both side. Enjoy, and I'll be back after I hit the jacks.
I don't think we're getting menus.
Well, cheers. I mean, oh, sláinte.
Cheers.
Blink.
All right, here's another one for you. So we'll go no more wrong. We'll go no more wrong than no wrong than in the night. We'll go no more wrong than lads, the moon shines so bright. We'll go no more wrong than
Oh, you good? I'd like to be out on the terrace getting polluted myself.
I'm not even going to guess.
Get out of the garden. I said I need a drink.
Hey, you're right, hatchet Molly.
Oh, this blind cobbler's though.
Oh, you're just sore because I got a glad eye for that caked up girl and cutting out early.
Wow, honey, there's two of them.
You look like a shaper selling funny flour.
I am knackered.
Big front slope like your bloody nixer.
I'm mad as a box of frogs, Mary.
You're a chancer, you're Ronnie Paul.
Oh, I'm looking to hop into a number two tonight. Good night, love.
Good night, da.
Are you okay?
Of course, that was my da. Not laying, but just saying good night.
It seemed like you guys were fighting.
Nah, he's locked out of a tree like a monkey who forgot his keys.
Oh yeah, that totally clears it up.
I think that means it'll take him a while to find his way home because he was so drunk.
Oh. Crack on, that's right, you're brilliant.
Oh, thanks, I think I'm catching on to this whole Irish jargon thing. Hey, where are you from in Ireland anyway?
Well, I'll tell you a secret, yeah? Actually, I'm from Delaware, so... But if I talk like this, it helps me tips.
Holly Laurent, Mike Yard, Greg Hess, and Serena Brooke, one more time for Béla Fleck and Edgar Meyer. Mr. Edgar Meyer, a tune of his called Green Slime, and Béla Fleck. Well, it has been a heck of a week for musicians' birthdays, but we're only gonna celebrate one of them, because to my surprise and delight, as I was studying this week's list, tomorrow is Donald Lunny's birthday. Donald Lunny, bazookiest and producer extraordinaire, and by the way, if you're wondering what a bazooki is, it's a Greek instrument that became foundational to Irish music largely because of Donald, and it sounds something like this. Which is a tune that I heard Donald Lunny play with Plinksting. So, Lunny is also the only founding member of both Plinksting and the Bothy Band, which is basically the Irish equivalent of being a founding member of the Beatles and the Stones. Donald helped form Plinksting in 1972, and if you haven't had the pleasure, pick up The Well Below the Valley, which is a veritable feast of improvised counterpoint between Donald's bouzouki and Andy Irvine's mandolin. Here's the second track off that record. This is Pat Riley. One, two, three. It being on a Monday morning, it being our payday, we met Sergeant Jenkins at our going away. He says to Pat Riley, "You are a handsome young man. Now come to John Kelly's and we will get a jam." And while we sat there boozing and drinking our jam, he says to Pat Riley, "You are a handsome young man. I'd have you take the bounty and come along with me to the sweet county Larkspur. Strange faces there you'll see." "Oh, no, kind sir, a soldier's life with me would not agree, for I'd never want to be bounded up from my liberty, 'cause I live as happy as a prince, my mind it tells me so. So fare thee well, I'm just going to my shard no for to throw. Oh, are you in a hurry? Are you going away? Oh, won't you stop and listen to these words I'm going to say? Perhaps now, Pat Riley, you might do something worse than to leave your native country and enlist on the back horse." Mr. Chris Albers there playing the bouzouki part of Donald Lunny. So if Plinksting is the Beatles, the Stones are the Bothy Band, which Donald left Plinksting to form in 1975. Julie Fowlis, how and when did you first hear of the Bothy Band?
I actually didn't hear of the Bothy Band until I was in my late teens. But in the 70s, they combined Irish traditional music with some Scottish Gaelic songs, actually. And they just absolutely set the traditional music world on fire.
And tell us a bit about this beautiful song in Gaelic from their second record, I think.
Yeah, it's one of my favourites. It's a really beautiful traditional song. It's from the Hebrides. And it was sung by the late and the wonderful Micheál O'Donnell, who is very sorely missed. And this, like so many Gaelic songs, is a song of unrequited love.
Okay, so it looks like Colum Sigair. What is it actually called, the song?
The song is called Colum Scadia.
Valida sorrow, valida sorrow, valida sorrow, o Gios nahui, o chrigr traumos ne sate homo. Shake a lock on.
this smile if he show up. So high come horse the smart guy be must could ye horn said
One more time for the miracle that is Julie Fowlis.
So just cash, only cash, only cash.
Sometimes I feel like the measure of a musician is how often their work is played by other musicians. I've heard the jig we're about to play at just about every Irish session I've ever attended and played more or less exactly how Donal Lunny and Company recorded it. Here from the Bothy Band's eponymous debut is the Kesh Jig.
One, two, three,
back there on the fiddle. And we'll polish off this Donal Lunny birthday celebration with a song from Paul Brady's debut solo record, Welcome Here, Kind Stranger, recorded under Donal's watchful ears. As producer, here's Aoife O'Donovan with I Am a Youth That's Inclined to Ramble.
I am a youth that's inclined to ramble to some foreign country I mean to steer. I'm loath to part from my friends and comrades, my dear sweetheart whom I love dear. But there's one of those I prove more successful. All ever I think when I'm far away. But since fate's decreed, I am resolved to part her in quarter vision in America. So farewell, darling, since I must leave. Place great dependence on your constancy. But know that you're man may gain your favor. I change your mind when I pour the sea. For though the seas they do separate us, between us they do rise and fall. But if fortune favors me, you'll find you, Jamie, returning homeward from America. Oh, Jamie, dear, do you remember when I sat with you for many is the hour, and my young fancy away was carried, and the bees hummed around us on each opening flower. But when you crossing the Western Ocean, the maiden loved you, you'll never mind a war, and you'll scarcely think upon the maids of Erin, for you'll find strange sweethearts in America. Oh, Mary dear, to all other fair maids I'll prove untrue. And if you think that these are false promises, I'll leave these vows as a pledge to you. But would I have may prove unsuccessful, fortune proved to me a slippery ball, that a favorite gale may ne'er blow on me, if I forsake you in America. And to conclude and to end these verses, may God prove this young female fair, and keep her from every wild embarrassment, and oh my darling, take the greatest care, for she's slow to anger and of kind disposition, and her cheeks like roses in June do belong. In my nightly slumbers, whene'er I think on her, I could court her vision in America.
Thank you for that, Aoife O'Donovan. Happy birthday, Donald Lunny.
There we go. Yeah.
Bodies. Bodies. Can't you see what everybody wants from you? Forgive the kids, for they don't know how to live. Run the alleys, casually cruel, cruel. Can't you see what everybody wants from you? For you could want that too. They could take or leave you, so they took you, then they left you. How could they be casually cruel? Cruel. Ooh. you can walk that too, then you'd be happy. You were the ones waving flags in the air so they could see.
That local break was sponsored by Babbel, a European-made language learning program. Babbel teaches practical conversation in Spanish, French, German, and other languages, available in the App Store or online at babbel.com. Please make welcome one more time to Carnegie Hall, Maeve Higgins.
Thank you. In the 5 years I've lived in New York, I've grown used to excruciatingly sincere exchanges with people. Within minutes of meeting you, they'll come up with the heavy goods and they'll expect to see yours in return. I've collected some specimens for you. Hey, how are you? Well, I guess what I'm afraid of is that my husband is bored of me. Oh, sorry. There's also this one. So, I don't know if you heard that, but I've got digestion issues. Oh no, I didn't hear it. You know, Americans are good at a great many things. Normalizing drone warfare. Making cherry-flavored jellies taste more like cherries than cherries themselves. Very good at optimism. But I feel like Americans struggle with small talk. Especially in New York. In Ireland, small talk is just that. I mean, it's tiny. At the beginning of a 3-hour train trip between Cork and Dublin, I spend an average of 15 minutes comfortably discussing the merits of having a cafe car on the train with the middle-aged man beside me. I suppose if you're peckish, it's ideal, you know? It is. The tea is expensive, though. Yeah! Everybody's eyes widen, everybody's heads nod in agreement, but then you can't dip chocolate into your ticket. What? Okay. What this seemingly meaningless exchange means is that we can relax. The person that we're inches away from for the whole afternoon is not dangerous. At the end of the trip, we'll nod and smile, and I won't be left wondering why his father said that one thing to him in 1994 that meant he never had the confidence to pursue architecture. The last kid's birthday party I attended was in Brooklyn, where the adults stick around and it kind of blends into the evening. It was a really fun party. I was chatting with this one, like, cool guy dad, you know those guys? He had like a pale ale in his hand. he opened up within 30 seconds. He said, something that people don't talk about enough is like how difficult parenting really is, you know? Sometimes you're just not gonna like your kids. I just asked him, was he online for the bouncy castle? I didn't have the heart to tell him that actually two other people at the same party had said more or less the same thing to me within minutes. Was this disgruntled trio just unlucky with a bunch of particularly irritating children between them? No, they were just telling me what was on their minds. I find that there's really nothing New Yorkers don't talk about. And I think that that should come as a relief to me, you know, because I grew up in quite a repressed, very Catholic country. And in truth, this extraordinary level of openness I find here, it is a relief, but it also feels a little like a loss. I understand that openness beats secrecy and that taboos should be challenged. It's just that I don't always want to dive right in. Time and energy are resources, and New Yorkers never have enough of either because of capitalism and self-absorption. Their technique is to get straight into it, and that can be off-putting. Besides, believing and acting on this no-nonsense, who exactly are you, school of conversation neglects that the fact that small talk, when it's done correctly, is actually an extremely efficient way of getting acquainted with people. You mightn't find out where they work or who they know or how their relationship with their dad is, but you'll get some idea of that odd-shaped part of a human being that's invisible to the eye and impossible to articulate. Are they kind? Are they hurting? Are they silly? Are they bad? Are they some combination of all of those things? You can find out. Just ask them about the party food, or tell them about your blouse, or bring up the oddly cloudless sky outside, and then simply take it from there. Thank you.
Miss Maeve Higgins. And welcome back to the stage, Julie Fowlis.
So I'm going to do something which is a little bit different for you now. I'm going to sing a song that's in two languages, in Scottish Gaelic and in Galego, in Galician, both of which are probably hugely useful to all of you. But this is a song which started life as a traditional Galician song, and one of the great joys of making music and being a professional musician is getting to collaborate, and I love nothing more than getting to spend time with other musicians and share with them, learn from them, and this next song came out of a collaboration between Galician and Scottish musicians, and it's a heartfelt song, and I guess it's something that I like to be mindful of. When you're sharing cultures like that, it's so important to recognize where you came from yourself, to stand up and celebrate that, whilst at the same time extending a hand to those around you, different cultures, different languages, and welcoming them all in. So this is a song called Camarinas.
Said por camarinas, por camarinas, cantando. Por pasar por camarinas, por camarinas, cantando. Nenas de camarinas quedan no río lavando. As nenas de camarinas quedan no río lavando.
One more time for Julie Fowlis. And one more time for Béla, Fleck and Edgar Meyer. Thank you. Song of Mr. Béla Fleck there called Bubbles. Béla Fleck on the banjo, Edgar Meyer on the bass. And one more time for the great Paul Muldoon.
Why Bronley left and where he went is a mystery even now. For if a man should have been content, it was him. 2 acres of barley, 1 of potatoes, 4 bullocks, a milker, a slated farmhouse. He was last seen going out to plough on a March morning. By noon, Brownlee was famous. They had found all abandoned, with the last rig unbroken. His pair of black horses, like man and wife, shifting their weight from foot to foot and gazing into the future.
Oh, for the money that e'er I had, I spent it in good company. And of all the harm that e'er I'd done, alas, was done to none but me. And all I've done for want of wit, to memory now I can't recall. So fill to me the parting glass, good night and joy be. Of all the comrades that e'er I had, they are sorry for my going away. And of all the sweethearts that e'er I had, they would wish me one more day to stay. But since it falls to my lot that I should rise and you should not, I gently rise and I softly call, good night and joy be with you all. Oh, if I had money enough to spend and leisure time to sit awhile, there is a fair maid in this town that sorely has my heart beguiled. Her rosy cheeks and ruby lips, I own she has my heart enthralled. Then filled to me the parting glass, good night and joy be with you all.
That's our show from Carnegie Hall in New York City.
Live From Here is produced by American Public Media. A big thank you to our special guests, Paul Muldoon, Tony DeMarco, James Keane, Alice Greta Ryan, Aoife O'Donovan, Maeve Higgins, Julie Fowlis, Edgar Meyer, and Béla Fleck. are live from here. Actors and writers are Holly Laurent, Greg Hess, Mike Yard, and me, Serena Brooke, with head writer Tom Papa. A big thank you to our house band with musical director Mike Elizondo. Thank you to our creative director, Joey Ryan. Thanks to the staff of Live From Here in Carnegie Hall, and a special thanks to the members of WNYC. Tune in next week for our live broadcast from the Fitzgerald Theater in St. Paul with our special guest host, John Batiste, and guests Emily King and Nick Waterhouse.
Live From Here is supported by Babbel, a European language program. European-made language learning program, Babbel teaches practical conversation in Spanish, French, German, and other languages. Available in the App Store or online at babbel.com. And by T. Rowe Price, offering a strategic investing approach that examines opportunities firsthand since 1937. T. Rowe Price, invest with confidence. And by One Drop, the all-in-one solution for people with diabetes. Supplies are home-delivered, and personal coaches help lower blood sugars. Get more at onedrop.com. Thanks for joining us in Carnegie Hall.
American Public Media.